Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The History of Political Thought, A Very Short Introduction, by Richard Whatmore, narrated by Jonathan Cowley. Chapter 1. History and Politics. Hats and Elephants. What is the corpulent man doing riding the elephant with a human face? Why is he dressed like a pasha, and what is the meaning of the banner held by the thinner, bespectacled man beside him? Why are they walking down Leadenhall Street? What is the meaning of the image? The history of political thought can answer such questions. The obese figure is Charles James Fox, an English Whig politician famous for his debauched life and gambling addiction. He is riding an elephant with the face of the Prime Minister, Lord North, infamous for continuing the war against the 13 colonies that became the United States of America. The man leading the elephant is Edmund Burke, still described by many as the founder of modern conservative doctrine. At the time, Fox and Burke were pushing through the British Parliament a bill to reduce the power of the East India Company. Burke especially was critical of the horrors practiced by empire builders, epitomized for him by the British Governor General of Bengal, Warren Hastings. Burke was soon to spend years seeking to impeach Hastings for corruption. The print by James Sayers of December 1783 does not applaud the actions of Fox and Burke in promoting decolonization in India as well as in North America. Rather, Sayers accuses both men of seeking to turn themselves into what was called at the time Oriental despots, introducing into Britain foreign tyranny and an addiction to luxury associated with the East. This is why the flag has Fox's traditional self-depiction of Man of the People scribbled over and replaced by Basilef Vasilufis, or King of Kings. Burke's map of India has territories from Delhi to Fort St. George and the Bay of Bengal, specified as being Fort CF, or Charles Fox's personal empire. Their takeover is to be presented to the offices of the East India Company in Leadenhall Street in the City of London. Impending disaster is signalled by the raven above with an etching, "The night crow cried foreboding luckless time." This is a reference to Shakespeare's play Henry VI Part 3, Act 5, Scene 6, where the king curses Richard III, Gloucester, for his evil deeds before being murdered by him. The print was so successful in maligning Fox's and Burke's India Bill that it was rejected by Parliament. North's government soon fell. Sayers's warning was that those who portray themselves as the friends of the people can easily be tempted into tyranny. The image epitomizes commonplace perceptions of the East, contributing to the positive othering of Europe and the prejudice of Orientalism. History explains politics. The history of political thought reveals the variety of perceptions of political projects, actions, and utterances, the hopes of their perpetrators and the fears of their critics. Knowledge of the history of ideologies can be revelatory. It makes us aware that those who wear pussy hats today are not only ridiculing Donald Trump and providing an alternative to his Make America Great Again caps, but are also affirming a long tradition of liberty headgear, going back to the Roman pileus or hat worn by emancipated slaves. Yet pussy hats resemble Phrygian caps symbolic of liberty. Phrygia was a Bronze Age kingdom in Anatolia. King Midas of Phrygia, renowned for his lust for gold, can be seen on ancient Greek coins wearing such a cap, as can the Trojan hero Paris in Roman art, because Troy too was in the Roman province of Hellespontine Phrygia. Phrygian caps, like Fox's turban, have Orientalist origins in their association of the East with luxury, empire, and the mysticism of the religious Mithras cult. How they became across Europe, the bright red Phrygian caps, symbolic of a willingness to die in the cause of freedom, is the kind of story the history of political thought can unravel. Liberty in history. A useful starting point in the history of political thought is to take one of the most inspiring utterances ever made. Man is born free, but is everywhere in chains. Taken at face value, Jean-Jacques Rousseau's infamous commencement of his Contrat Social, 1762, was a call to rebellion and acknowledgement of ubiquitous human bondage. This was one reason why his book was burned for being destructive of government and religion at Geneva and in France only months after it was published. Rousseau was then attacked for being an incarnation of one of John Milton's hellbound demons described in Paradise Lost. It was also why Rousseau's work was widely celebrated and denounced decades later for inspiring the French Revolution. Rousseau's writings appeared to have a clear message: protest and rebel against the corruption and tyranny you find all around you. The censors who cast Rousseau's works into the flames may not have read them, nor may the revolutionaries who venerated Rousseau as the patron saint of rebels. Certainly neither party understood Rousseau's profound political message. Rousseau, in subsequent writing and in numerous letters to friends, asserted that his Contrat Social had been entirely misunderstood. His book had asserted that once liberty was lost, it could only with difficulty be recovered. Where corruption reigned, for Rousseau this was epitomized by Paris, there could be no possibility of successful reform, let alone popular revolution. Rousseau's broader point was that political argument, especially in democratic fora, was likely to be meaningless because it was so easy to delude the people through rhetoric or their admiration of rich and powerful demagogues. Political thinking was the most difficult of subjects, Rousseau felt, because small states, the only states where people could ever be happy or free, were in the modern world dominated by larger or wealthier states. The latter were addicted to the pursuit of power through money. The lust for gain corrupted everything in commercial societies. The consequence was that reforms, however well-intentioned, so often went astray. Recovering what Rousseau actually thought is one of the goals of the history of political thought. It is worthwhile because individuals such as Rousseau, a watchmaker's son born in the Calvinist Republic of Geneva, still have a lot to say to us. In Rousseau's case, he saw himself to be sending a warning to people living in commercial societies that they were doomed to repeat a cycle of war and rule by tyrannical Caesar figures. Small states were likely to become endangered species. Politics would increasingly be seen through a glass darkly, especially by credulous populations, and steps needed to be taken to address the deep malaise. Revolution, rather than making things better, would always make things worse. Surely, it might be said, all that anyone has to do to understand Rousseau is to read his books, either in translation or in the original language. One of the points that will be made here is that if you want to recover the historical meaning of an author's argument, you have to reconstruct the assumptions about politics in the author's own time. You need to immerse yourself in the writings of the period with the aim of understanding what mattered to political actors, what they perceived themselves to be doing, and what their senses were of the range of options open to them. It was inconceivable for Rousseau, for example, to imagine a democracy in a large state. He would have said it could not exist because popular free government relies on people showing a culture and being willing to sacrifice themselves for one another, something only possible where states are small enough for citizens to know and appreciate one another. Do such opinions matter? Recasting an author's ideas by reference to contemporary controversy helps to register their ongoing import. Rather than being seen as a proto-democrat or revolutionary, it makes more sense to understand Rousseau as those in his own time did, diagnosing contemporary ills in addition to those that were on the horizon. Rousseau questioned whether people who called themselves republicans lived in sustainable republics, and whether those who called themselves democrats were in fact making a category mistake. Rousseau was falsely accused by critics of being an enemy of the present, an advocate of life as hunter-gatherers or noble savages, and of wanting, as his enemy Voltaire once put it, to return humanity to walking on all fours. Rousseau loved plants, animals, and indigenous societies because he considered them to be closer to nature, but he was brutally realistic about politics past and present. Some of his closest readers called him a cynic, in part because he was so clear-headed about the difficulty of solving problems in human societies without recourse to war. People gathered together by politics, according to Rousseau, so often became like members of missionary religions, seeking to battle members of other churches in order to convert them. People within churches, however committed they might initially be to their brothers and sisters who shared their beliefs, were likely to split off and form new sects, initially deemed purer than those they were replacing. Impulses to convert and dominate by incorporating others into your own empire had somehow to be avoided. Such an aspiration was difficult enough in a single society. Between competing nations, it was next to impossible. One of the points Rousseau made was that real change in politics only occurred after the experience of acute crisis. Once humans relaxed again, when Damocles' sword appeared to have disappeared from the air, the old corruptions would return. Despite the gargantuan difficulties faced by politics proper, it was the most essential work in the world, Rousseau said, to defend the small communities in which people lived across the globe, as they were the places where people were happier and less disposed to violence. Rousseau considered such communities to be ever more endangered by the progress of commercial societies seeking empire. Although he was open about his own failure to find solutions, admitting that the contrat social was an unfinished book in consequence, being aware of the nature of the crisis and the partial solutions to date that were certain to fail represented a significant contribution to knowledge. Limits, uncertainties, unintended consequences, and failures perhaps amounted to political wisdom itself for Rousseau. Today we live in a period when crisis is once again all around us. The democratic and liberal politics that were for a long time seen to be second nature, even an end of history, are now recognized to be fragile. Many commentators argue that liberal democracy may not survive the current generation. In addition, the combinations of politics and commercial society that brought industrial development through the 20th century to so much of the globe, always in the form of the unparalleled exploitation of natural resources, but with a liberal or a Marxist justificatory veneer, can now be seen to be threatening life on Earth. When change is necessary, looking to the past becomes vital for the simple reason that past generations have faced comparable predicaments. In politics, they have experienced everything, and nothing at all is new. That is why the history of political thought as a subject is more essential than ever before. This book describes the currently dominant approaches to the subject and some of the issues that the history of political thought faces going into the future. Chapter 2: Definitions and Justifications. Varieties of Histories of Political Thought. The history of political thought as a distinctive field of research is a recent development. Historically, however, every society has formulated histories of political thought from the anodyne to the systematic. In the past, Where politics has been closely entwined with the worship of deities on whom the survival of a society is held to depend, myths and histories become enmeshed. Using the heralded opinions of the gods to undertake sometimes radical innovation is commonplace in the history of political thought. In order to reduce the power of Egypt's priesthood, Pharaoh Akhenaten declared the sun god to be the only deity and himself to be a descendant. The Roman Emperor Constantine's motto, "By the cross I will conquer," said to have been coined after defeating his rival Maxentius at the Milvian Bridge in 312 CE, was used to justify both the expansion of empire and Christian conversion. Adhering to the word of God or violating it could mean life, death, or slavery. Islamic traders in the interior of the Swahili coast during the medieval period considered those they enslaved to be infidels and therefore legitimate targets. They transported their human property to Arabia, Egypt, or Iraq. Enacting the apparent will of God could also mean salvation in the next life. Pope Urban II in 1095 declared that it was the duty of all Christians to take Jerusalem from the Muslims and that anyone who took part in what became the First Crusade would see their souls travel directly to heaven, much like certain Islamist understandings of jihad today. Another example comes from the history of Buddhism. In order to convert the Mongols, the third Dalai Lama, Sonam Gyatso, guaranteed in 1578 that his patron, Altan Khan, was a reincarnation of Kublai Khan and that his next reincarnation would undoubtedly occur in Mongolia, something which occurred with the disputed incarnation of Yonten Gyatso as fourth Dalai Lama, himself a descendant of Altan Khan. If the present is widely recognized to be a diminished version of the past, then historical politics becomes reified. Inhabitants of Abyssinia in early modern times lived among giant monoliths built using lost techniques and inscribed with a language the locals did not understand. King Izana of Aksum in the 4th century CE converted to Christianity, but the empire declined over following centuries and ultimately collapsed after defeat in war either by the Jewish queen Yodit, Gudit, in 960, or by a pagan queen, Bani al-Hamwiya, of the al-Damuta tribe. The historian Edward Gibbon later wrote that after Izana's loss, Ethiopia slept through a millennium-long dark age. Nevertheless, Ethiopia survived as an independent Christian state, despite being surrounded by Islamic polities, as the Prophet Muhammad forbade jihad after his daughter had been given refuge during the exile from Mecca. Perspectives upon history have always been key to Islamic political thought. Across Europe and Asia, belief in the superiority of ancient Rome to contemporary society was prevalent from medieval times to the 18th century. Roman and Greek culture was not only venerated, but inspired a rebirth of learning, now termed the Renaissance. Especially marked in the city-states of Italy and spreading through the actions of traveling humanists, the Renaissance saw ancient manuscripts copied and transported westwards, saved from destruction within the Byzantine and Ottoman empires. Translated into Latin, annotated, and published, these texts had a transformative impact upon life and thought. Classical writing, artifacts and art conveyed the view to numerous Europeans that their achievements in philosophy, art, literature, and military tactics were inferior to those of the Romans. Even as the arts, letters, and technology were seen to have improved, a quarrel erupted between those who believed in the superiority of the ancients and those who embraced the achievements of the modern world. On one side of the argument was the French poet Nicolas Boileau, who held that imitation of the ancients was the most apt aspiration for inferiors in the present. On the other, the polymath Bernard Le Bouvier de Fontenelle hailed the superiority of modern refinement and scientific and technological achievements. The battle was brilliantly lampooned by Jonathan Swift. If national myths and culture justify combat with other nations or peoples, or describe unjustly thwarted destinies in recent or ancient histories, these beliefs will be reflected in the history of political thought. If you perceive yourselves to be God's chosen people in a particular nation or tract of land, history can be used to justify acts of violence for the acquisition of additional territory. Although modern Italians are descendants of Lombards, Ostrogoths, Franks, and Normans, among many others, the national myth of being exclusively Roman was used by the fascist dictator Benito Mussolini in the 1930s to justify the invasion of Abyssinia to add to the colonies of Eritrea and Somalia secured during the 19th century European scramble for Africa. Adolf Hitler called the Treaty of Versailles ending the First World War a monstrous violation of the greatness and rights of the German people. In this view, the Germans had been victors over Rome at the Teutoburg Forest, and the iron will of the German people manifested itself in history until they were betrayed by foreign traitors. In the case of the United Kingdom, a country widely perceived to be in decline since it lost its empire, proposals have been made by governments to instill facts about past victories in war into the heads of primary and secondary school children. In Scotland, a different version of the history of political thought is widely propagated, describing the oppression of native Scots by the English and the loss of liberty, with a view to its recovery through independence. In Russia, a powerful role is played by national myths about Eurasianism, the belief that linked nomad tribes from the steppes, including the Scythians, Huns, Turks, Mongols, and Kievan Rus, have shaped world history. Slavophilia, inspired in part by the literature of Fyodor Dostoevsky, articulates a future distinctive from Western secular liberalism and socialism. Such assertions, associated with historic culture, translate into arguments in favor of a special destiny for Russia in the present. A perceived history of decline can lead to the transformation of politics. This is most manifest among the nations that saw themselves to have fallen behind European states militarily during the 19th century. In Japan, after the Warring States period, 1467 to 1568, and the long peace of the Tokugawa period, 1603 to 1868, although there were several intertwined philosophical movements among Kokugaku, Shinto, and Buddhist scholars, Confucianism was prominent through the work of figures such as Ito Jinsai, 1627 to 1705, Arai Hekuseki, 1657 to 1725, and Ogyu Sorai, 1666 to 1728, challenged by Ando Shoeki, 1703 to 1762, and redefined for modern times by Fukuzawa Yukichi, 1835 to 1901, and Nakai Chomin, 1847 to 1901, among others. The necessity of change was accepted, however, because of the acknowledgement that although Japan historically had been successful as a state, it could not compete with European powers. Fascination with the West became the norm. Interest in the history of political thought became European political thought on the grounds that this translated into national power and continued independence. Japan was opened to foreigners in 1853. The emperor was restored as the head of state in 1868, Meiji Restoration, to prevent Japan from itself becoming a subject territory. The defeat of Russia in the 1904-5 war for the control of Manchuria and Korea confirmed that the Japanese had met their goal. In future decades, they would seek to go beyond it by turning Japan into the dominant empire in Asia, which led in turn to the horrors of the Second Sino-Japanese War, 1937-45, the Asia-Pacific War, and on to Hiroshima and Nagasaki. China experienced the effects of relative military weakness directly during the Opium Wars against Britain, 1839-42, and France, 1856-60. That a state on the other side of the globe could crush with such ease a large state in Asia with a long history of civilization and independence had ramifications that continued to dictate attitudes to politics and history in China. The point has frequently been made, most recently by Youngmin Kim in A History of Chinese Political Thought, 2018, that Chinese political thought was distinctive because of the ancient Chinese statesman and philosopher Confucius, born Kong Chu, 551-479 BCE, and the Confucianism that resulted from the study of his ideas. While this is true in the most general of senses, we need to avoid reducing sinosphere thinkers to monoliths. Across East Asia, highly creative thinkers generation after generation engaged critically with the Confucian canon, whether the older five classics or the newer canon of the four books and Xu Xi's Neo-Confucian commentaries. It is possible to generalize by arguing that the Confucian four books made canonical during the Southern Song Dynasty, 1127-1279, had a message that became a cultural force. They taught self-cultivation and governance through the operation of the networks of individual, family, and state working together. The importance of avoiding conflict and of peaceful resolution of difficulties can be compared with the antagonistic relationships, for example, between feudal lords and kings in Europe, from which can be traced institutions of representative government. Social networks operating in accordance with Confucian principles have been seen behind the Ming, 1368-1644, and Qing, 1636-1912 dynasties. The actual operation of Confucian and Neo-Confucian philosophy in practice was infinitely more nuanced and complex, as becomes evident from the examination of the Ogyu Sorai, 1666-1728, who transformed traditional teachings in the hope of creating more stable government for the common good. It is a mistake, too, to argue that historically being Chinese and living in social harmony became synonyms. It was the case, for example, that during the Ming period, being Chinese became associated with a particular ethnicity. Legalism always justified violence when deemed necessary to maintain society. The key conclusion, however, is that the centralized state, active in the life and culture of its citizens, characteristic of communist China in the 20th and 21st centuries, has been a European import. As in the case of Japan, there was a...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.